happening during the day here. So we have a video installation by Nick Sandiland that's going on the back room. We will try to the live streaming to download a few of them online, a few examples of the, of this video, so you can so they can watch it a little bit also. And there was a video by Neil Curtis that couldn't make it today from Vienna, and not last week. He was supposed to do a four-hour performance titled Layers, where he covered 10 layers of paint model. And there was a beautiful video that he sent us, and it was running all day long in the gallery. So thank you, Neil, for sending it to us. That's it. Today, now, evening. So it's all about drawing machine, actually. So we're shifting a little bit from working with sort of electric and digital and projections and sound towards drawing machines. Joseph Wilk, who is our first guest artist, hi, is going to work, I think it's a painting machine, actually.
Accessibility.
And of course, we will hear a little bit more about the whole process. I'm looking forward. Following by Nick
Sayers.
Right? Sorry. There's the list, but it's still not working. Anyway, with drawing machine, but I think with a shift towards painting. So this is the third day. We have tomorrow the last day. And thank you for being with us. So I'm looking forward.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Can you choose?
Yeah. Hi, my name is Joseph Wilk. What I'm doing here is a drawing by my hand, which is the input to this whole process. And then drawing with code on this computer, which is taking with my hands and manipulating it, and then I'm manually playing around with that, and then that's coming over to the machine, and the machine through motion is then going to draw on this canvas. I am also putting paint by hand onto this canvas, and a bit of back and forth between the machine. My kind of frame for approaching these things isn't because they're digital, it's because they enable me and my body to perform. I have limitations with my movements that these machines facilitate in some way. And I appreciate that is a complex relationship, because these things are commodities, these things have a lot of baggage, and what we see as technology is, by the nature of the people who control it, it's very much framed as something. And from my perspective, as someone who experiences disability, I see it as something very different. It's about creative expression, it's about interrogating this tension between the machine and the human, and how that might reflect in the work. So hopefully we'll see some of this process. And because this is all live and technology doesn't work, that's kind of one of the important parts of it, lots will go wrong, and that's part of it. Okay, so the first thing I'm doing here is just going to, by hand, input a sketch line.
Come closer.
Yeah, feel free to have a look. The line I'm going to draw, this machine is not going to be running, so you don't have to worry about that. This line is going to be input and used by the code to generate a pattern. So I'm just going to have a little go here. Again, this isn't drawing, digital drawing. It is a different thing, but it means that I can use programming code to play around with drawing by code as well. So I'm just going to play around with the parameters of this, and this is where I'm thinking about the medium and the paint and how this is going to get translated to this. I'm trying to think about what I can fit in detail. I'm just going to have another go. I'm not happy about it. So effectively, this is the focal point, and all lines are gravitating to that, which is done by the code. So now, I'm just going to record that, and hopefully, unplug this and see if the computers are happy using themselves. I had trouble with this earlier. It's very upset that that was all just so I could use my hands to draw. Now I'm going to go and take that picture which I just drew. Feel free to move around as much as you'd like and have a look.
What are you coding in?
C++ and open framework. So this is the pattern that we just drew. And I'm just going to get this now ready for this machine, because this was drawn with motion, and that is what the important part is for this machine, and it requires a little bit of me planning and thinking how I'm going to use this motion to manipulate the paint and get the best out of this pattern, because none of these machines have any concept of mediums. That's to me to try and work out. Okay, so I'm just going to take this and put it into one of my systems. So this is the drawing I just did. And now I need an outline because I kind of need to know where to put the paint a little bit. So I'm just going to grab a few of these things. Take that line that I drew and pick the product. Put that down to the canvas. First mistake. Sorry. So I told it to draw the entire thing, which is the motion it's going to do with the paint. Which is actually not what we want. And again, it doesn't know that when I know that. These, but these ones they make bespoke, so you can't actually just buy them.
They make big boxes all the way.
Yes, exactly, yes. Yeah, they're lovely machines, and it's all open source, so technically you could go and build it. It's an Arduino that's plugged in there. It's just that this beam and the precision for the balance is quite hard to do.
So do they make it bespoke for you?
Yes. So they make smaller versions, you can buy them. Okay, so I'm just gonna turn now we'll draw actually what I want to do. Which is the line that I drew in my hand. Yeah, the servos moving around in the belt. Has a musicality to it, definitely. So that is my guide. Now I'm gonna put some paint on and actually use the pattern. These are just clay sculpting tools, which I found work pretty nicely in paint. So it's kind of a mixture of a bit of soft with some heavy body acrylics and some slow dry. Mainly because this machine can take a very long time to run. I mean, I'm hoping this will do within the time slot that I have, but I can quite happily do it for an hour or maybe two sometimes, and paint starts to rip, but it's kind of nice as well. Yeah, the paint will probably rip a little bit with this as well, but it kind of adds a nice texture to it. Now really it's me thinking about what that digital process was and how it generated the code, and I'm setting up the paint to maximize that pattern. So the center, I want to make sure it's as white as possible. And I'm thinking of the motion, there's all these lines coming towards this, so I'm going to try and set up as counter a pattern as possible. To do that. So I kind of actually need to give it individual commands.
Right.
But pen up and pen down means I can apply any level of pressure I want to, really. It's just a question of when the canvas will start to buckle or something. This is where a lot of the human hand comes in as well, as in while the machine is going to be very precise, what I'm doing here, as you can see, is very wobbly. It's because I'm nervous, so I get a bit shaky. But I like that. And I'm spilling paint as well in this.
It's moving from Jackson Pollock to Frank Stella.
I don't know who Frank Stella is, but I'll take that as a positive.
It's good.
Doing it live changes that interaction just a little bit, and I'm not
coming.
Yeah,
it's a little more stressful.
And
not pressure.
But the performance is valuable because already I've changed. I have absolutely no idea really how this will render because there's so much variability in it, just in the way that I play the laying of the paint, the way the pattern turns out. I think for me, the performance aspect is super important because it pushes me to think about the liveliness of the digital and how it leads to more unpredictability during it live. Which, the thing I don't like with the digital is the idea that just press play and it just kind of goes and does the perfect pattern. That to me I have no interest in because there's no feedback loop there. I want to see the fact that I've done this. I've probably done at least maybe 50 or 60 of these smaller sizes, not this pattern, but various pitches, so I've learned a lot about this process. And I'm curious to see how that affects what I do. Yeah. Close. This feels big.
Can you say again?
Acrylic, it's kind of a mixture of soft with a little bit of heavy body, just kind of messing around with the balance really to get something that lasts long enough and doesn't.
They're struggling to grab them.
Yeah, they are. But that's okay.
Yeah.
Again, they'll rip a little bit and I quite like that effect. And anyway, the machine is going to nicely stir everything. lot of the machine being so precise removes some aspects of the hand as well, so I'm actually like purposely missing bits which will hopefully never get touched. Like you said, it's starting to dry, so I'm just going to black, obviously, always knocks out the white a lot, so the white needs to reinforce. Mainly I want this bottle to finish as well, because then I can get a spray like I did. I should have emptied it by now, so I don't quite know what I did. Again, I'm kind of focusing on this because I know the pattern, I know the algorithm, and I know pen hand, so I know that a lot is about the intensity of this center point. So I want this to have a lot more intense paint mixing going on. Carried away with that split. No sensitivity to me, so it hits me by getting away. This is where the machine has no concept of the medium, it's just executing what I asked it to do.
Digital marbling.
Yes, very much so. Yeah. Just with a way that wouldn't be possible with the normal marbling tools. I think that's also where the kind of the generative digital comes in as an interesting interplay. Yeah, I'm taking a lot from Lola, very much so. That's not making traction.
Got a fixed height, or is it sort of like responding to the depth of the? I mean, is it like is there sort of certain gravity?
It's fixed as what I set it, but it was
right.
Wrong because there's some variability in the canvas and the machine itself. Actually, attempt black here because it really, throughout the mixing process, it's really quite have quite a shading effect on this area.
How long it takes to dry?
Sorry?
How long did you take for it to dry?
Usually 2-3 days. I think it reached today. It has a habit to slip as well, but that's because I'm pushing it quite fast as well, because I want to get it done on time. This is only the first. Yeah, it definitely doesn't work. It has no sensitivity, so it will continue pushing and
it will win.
Yeah. It knows no. Something making a sound, not just the mechanic. So it sounds like that sort of thing is almost like a sound chip.
So you can
sound out.
You can compose music with it. So I could put in a piece of music and get it to do a motion based on the music. So it's tunable. It's effectively the servos and the internal circuits in here, just as it pans around. So. You start to find that different pieces have different musicality. Spirals are beautiful because you get the tonal change, right? As it's rotating. So again, there's like an aspect of why I quite like spirals.
You're hearing that.
The
constant axis change of the.
Yeah, and you're hearing when it moves to some of the more precise patterns, it's really going to have a very different noise. It's keeping the edge. It's probably fun. Again, since the paint is drying, it's catching up, but the nice aspect is it will come to me. It's my tool. I think it's very important to frame how we use technology, and it is definitely not a friend. It's a tool that enables me to express myself in ways, but it's also designed not to do this. So I reckon the human is the value in trying to find what you want to use it for by breaking it down and building it back up. Because this is what the early printers were. Doing text mostly, and most people put pens in here, but why limit yourself to what it's designed for?
It's a friendly tool.
Yeah, I don't want to humanize it because, like I said, what would you describe my wheelchair as? What would you describe my glasses as? What would you describe the pen plotter as?
So you tell me that you didn't name it.
No, of course not. That would be a terrible thing to do. Again, it's like, I don't want to personify it, right? It's like me that has the input. Like, this is my expression. This is all me planned. The machine is just doing what I've told it to. And my back and forth with this process of actually understanding how this all works. But I see this, like, I wasn't joking when I said this is an accessibility aid. This enables me to move in ways that my body has trouble with. The wheelchair, I realize it's part of this performance, but isn't even in my head because it is a subconscious body to me.
Sure.
It doesn't even have any, it's not even there. It doesn't even occur to me that it's part of the performance just because it's so part of my body to me. So if anything, I'd like to think this is an extension of my body, of me, and not it being a thing.
Sure.
Because I think like a lot of narratives try to dehumanize and try to present technology as human, which is natural because that's what we like to do. And there is definitely a hole in computers and technology that people like to fill, especially companies with human chips. Sorry, that's it.
No.
It's a thing I hear a lot.
I
think it's
because
important.
I even name a bus for this one.
Yeah.
Name, so.
I get you. I think it's
absolutely about the understanding of different abilities. Like I say, I love you. Is it accessibility tool?
Yeah, accessibility.
Yeah.
Interesting. So it definitely got a bit wobbled, which is good actually. So we have like an offsetting on this side to this side where it got chipped a bit here. It's interesting that this side is perfect, but it's definitely, I think this will orientate outside of the point. Again, like, it's where the human again adds the value, right? As in, I can see that's interesting. The machine, it's an error. So now. We get to do the drawing.
More drawing?
Yeah, not done yet.
More
setup. It's just
what's
up,
eh?
And
you
can take your time.
No. But the drawing on the back of what you did it before?
Huh?
Or is another one?
So no, this is exactly what I drew on this iPad at the start. This is the setup process. So when I drew that, there was a bunch of code that was generating some of these patterns, and some of these were manually created and picked by me to facilitate. Again, it's that like computational human hand. It's a constant back and forth. Now this is a much finer tool, and we're gonna have to be aware that it's a little knockery and stick a bit more. It's a little lighter, so it does have a habit of getting a bit stuck, but we will move to that. Cool. Yeah, no, it's good. Just seeing what happens.
Joseph, any relation or any, do you like kinetic art or something that you doesn't really.
I mean, op art definitely is an influence. I do like op art, and I do like playing with perception and what's going on there. I feel like the digital hasn't. I think there's a lot that digital can add to op art and develop. Through playing more with screen-based work and playing more with precision of it, that I'm interested in. But I'm also trying to find like form and structure in this. This is purposely centered around this point to try and give it a bit more structure. Like I said, this is marbling, and the marbling can be quite abstract, and I'm trying to not make it just an abstract pattern. I actually want there to feel like there is something coming out, which is the drawing that I did. I guess I'm always thinking about it from the perspective of performance. I see performance as the most important part of this work. It's what's so cool to do this in front of people, because often I'm sitting in my studio doing this and I'm just like, look at this, this is really good fun, right? This is enjoyable, it's wonderful.
You turn around and there's no one.
And you can see the finished picture and be like, I don't care about the finished picture. It's about what's happening in the process, right? Because again, this is about the visibility of me as someone who identifies as disabled and how you've seen multiple phases of me using tooling to be visible to you. As in, what you just saw there was me and my thoughts condensed into pad, into code, into movement. And this is all me trying to think about how I want to get this and the variability that happens in it as well.
Do you do that on large scale, like big?
I've never done it bigger than this yet, mainly because I'm still learning a lot.
Yeah.
And I don't want to go
like
too big because.
It's
going to
be
mind blowing.
Mind blowing is this one. It's like growing, it's like, woo!
It's a lot to understand, I think.
thing for me personally, and I'm still really trying to.
It's about budget and supporting museums.
Yeah.
It's interesting. To know that you already saw that in your head when you were doing the sketch on the iPad, the way the machine moved then.
So now it's drawing your drawing.
Yes, now this is the original drawing, which is based on the line that I drew. Yeah, it's not a passive process. I have to keep an eye on it because it has no idea what it's doing. So.
It's okay.
I can talk. Yeah. It's just that it is. It's not just watching. It's also trying to.
It looks like to be like kind of the failed over peacock. I don't know. That's what I see in that.
Yeah.
But, you know, people see different things.
Well, this just makes me very happy. The fact this is mixed.
Not which, just you.
Which is, wasn't in the pattern, it wasn't in the drawings, but it's my understanding of the medium and what I'm doing that gives me that. Hebrew is the original, I think, of the water painting, the Turkish original art form. And they adapted that into marbling, which was used in the printing industry until the digital era kind of killed that off. It's considered an endangered craft, marbling. This is effectively, zigzags, but done in a spiral pattern is the marbling pattern. But you generally can't do zigzags in spirals because you tend to be working with wood with nails on it, so you can kind of move them in straight lines. So the idea of doing this and then coming back in on itself is quite hard to imagine with the two
lines. Yeah, you're sort of taking it. New area with the robots in Europe.
Yeah, very much so. Going to reinforce, I want to push the shapes a little more. It has like a more extreme effect by running the same pattern again. We're just getting stronger and stronger. We're getting stronger and stronger curves on these lines, and also we're getting more mixing, which means we're getting more intensity. Just kind of adds a little motion to it. And again, like, this wasn't in the original drawing, but it's just obvious to me that the second run will have a nicer effect. You can already start to see we're getting much more of the gray tones and more intermixing on this side.
So usually people use a pen or a marker to work with this tool, and is it you that decided to drag it through paint?
Yeah, so I started working with airbrushes and inks, and just blowing ink around using a machine holding an airbrush, moving it around. And then I started putting down paint medium to affect that. And that kind of naturally led to the fact that if I put an upside down paintbrush, I could start to get some interesting effects. Yeah, people generally don't work with paint. And watercolors is one thing some people use.
Watercolor?
Yeah, so just using the pen to effectively put in, or what you can do have is pots here, and pots are going to move their dripping to the block from over and move it part of it. It's kind of fun to see like what's happening and what's going on here, and how it's starting to get a bit of intensity, and also starting to keep drying throughout this process. It tends to be a little more extreme looking at.
Something more figurative, or
no? I haven't actually. There's a lot to explore.
Right, but it's not the limitation of the tool. It's rather your interest. Yeah.
I think I'm just still discovering a lot, learning a lot about how this can be used.
So how long have you been working, like creating art with this machine?
With this machine? With these machines? It's probably about 2 years.
Okay.
Yeah. There's a lot of development in just understanding, like this double swiping and things like this.
Mm-hmm.
It's the good bit, because it's the kind of the digital is very fast and failure is cheap, and this failure is more expensive and more time intensive.
Mm-hmm.
So it has a nice balance with the machine. I can generate thousands of pictures, pick which ones I want.
Mm-hmm.
This I can only do one, so I kind of end up with this generate huge number of things, pick one or two that I like, reduce them down, pick which one I like, and then do it on this machine and kind of have that like relationship.
Mm-hmm.
This is the expensive slow part, but also this is influencing the digital very much so, because I'm looking at this, I'm already thinking, you know, there might be some other things I might try and do here next time. Start to have other ideas about it.
So in theory, you can even potentially attach them on like a laser head and do that on wood. Ooh.
Yeah.
Ooh, that would be amazing. Oh my god. Yeah, because you can then carve in a wood, like let's say, like, you know, with potential.
Yeah,
like,
you kind of need cooling and clearing up the sawdust and stuff. But yeah, like, you know, it's a machine that moves on a 2D axis. So
yeah, of course, yeah, X and Y, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh.
Cool. I think I'll call that done. So thank you all very much for...
Oh, wow. Thank you. So these only two is just for this.
Yeah, I mean, I just prefer it like this for this specific style of this piece. I want the contrast to be strong. But the thing you get with using more colors is you can really intermix them, and you know, this will just turn into a mulch of like gray. While when you can use lots of colors, you actually get nice blends and nice gradients going on.
Sure.
So,
but you could also wait until it dries and apply more color on different layers.
Multi-layered. Yeah. I'm still thinking about that because it's quite an abrasive tool, as in it will rip.
Yeah, but you kind of create like etching into the previous layer. So or just you can well, it's just endless what you can create.
So
you create, not that you create, obviously the machine just, you know, executed what you tell it. Yeah.
Crazy.
Although I think it deserves a name. But that's okay. I respect you not naming it. But
Lila. Can you tell us a little bit about your activities? It's very performative. Does all other works that you do? I know that you're collaborating.
A little bit. So it all comes from the perspective of disability aids. And like I said, the wheelchair was part of his performance, even if it's not explicit. But also I'm working with South Bank Unlimited, using the motion of wheelchairs to create street art in public spaces. The idea being that disability being a social construction, as in physical public spaces, create barriers for people like stairs. In fact, I can't go somewhere because stairs are. And so it's a way of just using a phone and some sensors to use your wheelchair motion to effectively leave words on the floor. Does it make sense to leave street art on the floor for a wheelchair user? Quite hard to reach up high, so the floor is the space to use.
And perfect canvas.
Yeah, exactly. And we'll be making these trails all over central London September the 6th, 7th, 8th, I think. Effectively, people expressing how spaces make them feel and exploring the motion of wheelchairs and the aesthetics of wheelchairs as well, which is super interesting.
Which was also, I remember now that you've been asked if you're doing a figurative. And you've been working with quite a lot of symbol of disability.
Yes.
And
together with Stuart.
Distorted it in a way, you know, played with it, the symbol.
Yeah, the disabled icon, again, it's kind of it's a very static image, and I don't associate it with it as a wheelchair user, and so it's interesting to me creatively how I can transform and manipulate the wheelchair symbol.
Which one?
But it's
the one that
Yeah, exactly. In the US, it's often actually a wheelchair in motion with kind of the arms pushed back. There's a movement, the Accessible Icon Project, which is all about replacing the static wheelchair with a more active wheelchair. And
this piece was a procedural generation of just looking what it might look like if it was grown as a plant, looking at the angle of hands and what hands tell you about the disabled symbol, like hands in the air in joy or back in like free fall or like panic, and just like what the how the wheelchair frames how you see those arm gestures. Sure. Like in the air, is that like you're because of the wheelchair you're in danger, or is that the joy of going on really fast?
Any other questions?
Is your background in computing and programming? Or
yes, yeah. I have a master's degree in computing from Imperial College.
Oh.
A long while back. And it took me a long time to discover using programming for creative expression.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you, how did you come about that? So I know this.
No,
it's
good.
I know it's going to be like.
So it really came about in the relation to the disability in the wheelchair. It's why I connect the two. I was working as a programmer, effectively working for a company. It was very dull, very boring. And my wheelchair started to break. And legally, the health and safety, I'm not actually allowed to fix my own wheelchair. You're not supposed to because you're not trained to do it, which really jarred me at the time. And I started to realize that this is my body, and the idea of not being able to fix my own body when it's broken is ludicrous. And that challenge of like reframing what I thought the wheelchair has and seeing it as my own body made me do the same thing to code. So I started to question, like, I'm sitting here writing code for a company, what do I want to do with code? What do I want to explore? What do I want to say with it? And that naturally led to me doing music performances, writing code live, algo raves. Lots of ways of exploring my visibility, and especially with this kind of like indirect, direct way of, you know, if I project my laptop on the screen, people can start to see my mind without my body, which means they can explore like what I'm thinking without me necessarily being framed as a wheelchair user. So that was really interesting. And it's kind of spiraled on from that, the ideas of controlling your visibility through automation and programming.
Wow. Amazing. Do you do any workshops? I mean, do you talk about it like a mobile workshop, this kind of spreading the idea and seeds?
Yeah, so I do lots of workshops, mainly with marginalized groups. I'm quite interested in introducing this stuff to people who don't necessarily have experience with technology.
Yeah.
I think the physical digital relationship is quite an important way to teach this stuff because it's kind of not trapped in the screen, it actually comes out and manifests itself in the real world, which I think is quite a valuable way to teach.
It's tangible.
Yeah.
You can see where it's going to be 0110 there. You can see that. Yeah.
It's also framing what, again, come back to what I was saying at the beginning of the fact that what these technologies are, what programming are, is very much framed within the companies who control these things. Mm-hmm. And the idea that computing or programming is a computer science or an engineering subject, I think are completely rubbish. It's not a science, it's not engineering, it's more like linguistics, it's more like language. Mm-hmm. And that is an important perspective to take, not just in what programming or digital is, but also in terms of diversifying the audience to participate. Because as soon as you talk about it, maybe as humanities, maybe programming is humanities, maybe it's framed in a lot of the interfaces are all framed in the social history of Silicon Valley in America. As soon as you start to frame some of these technologies and what they say about us, you start to get to anthropology, linguistics, which opens up the audience.
Wow.
Cool.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Second performance, we have your mix.
Say it.
Yeah.
so many things under one umbrella. So I'll leave it to you later on. You can start by demonstration, but we're going to ask a question. So.
Sure, yeah, and feel free to ask questions. I'm all other questions.
But you're choosing during the demonstration or
after? During's good. I'm an artist based in Coste, in the west of Brighton, and I make sort of art to do with science, often using everyday materials. So I normally bring these to sort of art festivals and science festivals and schools, sort of exploring sort of maths and engineering and astronomy, photography, optics, various different things to do with science, but sort of trying to find sort of fun ways of exploring various topics. So this is a body miniaturizing machine. So I was actually commissioned to make a sculpture out of lots of little mini body outlines, and it occurred to me in a weird dream, I woke up one morning and thought, I'll make a giant version of this toy that I had when I was a kid called a sketchograph. And this was a thing you could use before, you know, any sort of like computers came along, where you could take a drawing and trace around it, and you get like a miniature version of it. So what I'd like to do is this is the audience participation part stage of the evening. And I'll choose four people, like two women, two men. Who wants to be? Who wants to be my first subject? you've been chosen. Yeah, you might want to take first. So yeah. Okay. So what I'm going to do is, if you can lie down on the mat, and I'll sort of demonstrate. So. So you need to be sort of like just in from the edge of the paper of the mat, and with your fingers spread out, kind of jazz hands.
That's it. Your gesture.
That's it. You just shuffle down a little bit. That's it. That's it. That's fine. That's fine. I'm just gonna.
Okay.
And then if you just spread your fingers out nice and wide. Should have got paper ready first, shouldn't I, really?
Well, tell me what you're going to do, maybe.
That's it. Well, actually, we'll be able to see it. So engravers used to use these to trace. They wanted to sort of draw really small lettering on engraved lettering on a small piece of silverware. They'd use a pantograph. This is called pantograph, incidentally, which means draw everything. And they'd trace around big letters, and it would be sort of translated into small lettering on the piece of silver that they were engraving.
like you're running away from something.
There you go. Yeah, hang on, I'm just going to take a quick cool. I still have a
change the position of the subject?
What I'm working towards, because what we're going to do next is we're going to introduce four pictures together for a sort of composite piece. So, but yeah, normally they can just pose in whatever direction they want.
I like your sneakers and drawing. Two.
be had to do it differently.
That's me.
Okay, I might just because I was otherwise you look a bit blobby, so I'm just gonna move your leg a little bit.
It's spread.
Is that the video?
It's broadcasting.
Yeah. Try not to swear.
I can sleep now.
I'll sleep too much.
It's like going to the hairdresser and going to kill me.
Shuffle trace around. You want to just hover just above the ground, so try not to drag it or lean it, and go as close as you can to the outline of clothes and shoes and hair and so forth. And then sort of hover above the fingers to get the shape of them.
Okay. Give it a go.
I should set a tape away, and then we give it a trip.
Oh, well, we trust it well, then.
This is a top, an old toddler bike.
This one I actually designed for, I was invited to a painting festival in Egypt, and I was like, hell yeah, I want to go to Egypt. But hell no, I'm not a painter. So I'd made some drawing machines before, so I decided to make one that could paint instead. And because it was in Egypt, I had to make it so that it fit into a plane. So all the pieces of this are no longer than 50 centimeters long. So that's why I chose the top of the bike. And then also this whole framework takes apart into different pieces. And yeah, I managed to sort of get it sort of packed into a sort of medium-sized suitcase. I then actually made another one in to go to South Korea, which was my last foreign trip before the pandemic. That's another whole one you can see on my... I've made, I think, four spirograph machines now, and a harmonograph one as well, and also do, like, I've made a whole set of bicycle cogs, and then made laser cut wheels that you can draw conventional spirograph patterns with pens. What we're going to do here is I initially designed this to work with paint, so it's got, because it's only got one gear, there's only one pattern that it's drawing. So to sort of to give it variation, I've made a space for five different bottles. So I had a spectrum of colours that I did one by one. And you'll see, like, well, just to sort of show you how it works. I've got sand in here, is what I usually use when I go to science festivals, because you can sort of quickly lay down a pan and then just sweep it off into a bucket, and then we can do another one. So what we can do is I'll have three volunteers this time. Yeah. Got a very steady hand, he'll be good. Yeah. Come on, kiddies. Okay, so what we can do is it's a bit like pass the parcel. What we can do is just I'm gonna pass the saddle around. So you can just stand, or either put your feet just out the side of the thing, or you can stand just for sort of, but just be aware that it's going to make a pattern here. So what I'm going to do is just pass the saddle sort of slowly and steadily around. Try and keep your hands on it all the time, so that it doesn't sort of go spinning off sort of too fast. That's it. We'll just go around once more just to get the sense of it. I'll unleash the sand. You can step onto the mat if you're really stretching to get it. Yeah. Cool. Okay, that's good for it. Tell you what the number of cogs, teeth at the front cog and the back cog are, but I can't. I can't remember. But it's all to do with it's all to do with prime factors. So if the prime factors of the front cog go into the back cog, you get simple patterns. And if they're sort of like big prime numbers, so if you have like a sort of 30 the back cog must have 13 teeth and the front one. So it's, there's the number of times it goes round and the number of petals it has dictated by the number of teeth on the front and back cogs. There's a whole sort of like more complicated math side to it, but I always find it really difficult to explain. yeah, so that's one of the, so by changing the which hole you put the paint pot into, it creates more or less, this is the biggest pattern, but there's other ones where it sort of makes a sort of like a sort of ring in the middle there. Actually, yeah, let's have the same again. So, I'll see what this one does. Go for it. Yeah. Okay, so yeah, let's go wrap this box around just to get the hang of it. So, yeah, nice and slow and steady. So I just put the bottle into one of the, so it's a different radius. So it's essentially the same, it's kind of the same
it's going to have the same number. It'll have 13 sort of petals to it, but it'll just be, it's got sort of quite sort of more curvy petals this time.
Oh my god.
Was the best for paint.
Whoa.
So, because it's got this quite neat nozzle that sort of, you sort of push and pull to get it open and closed.
That's your very genius.
Cheers, thank you. Yeah, so I mean, like, because they sort of like evolved as I've taken different events as well, like these other machines. And so that whole thing with the milk bottles full of water as ballast and, yeah, very subtle.
That was very
human being.
Yes.
Like,
yeah. Is it also part of your practice that you work to sort of recycle material, or is it only to because you were short of
bond? A bit of both, really. So I guess sort of there's that sort of art of era movement, which is about sort of taking everyday materials, but also. Yeah, I just a lot of sort of science art or maths art is just very cold and sort of it's like sort of computer generated. It's very or it's sort of 3D printed and it's got this sort of it's sort of interesting and sort of complicated and detailed, but it's it can be quite sterile and sort of unrelated to the real world. So I quite like to make things that relate to the real life. So. Yeah, like the findings of sort of maths in cycling, or I've made sort of pinhole cameras out of beer cans, and I've made rooms. I've actually brought it here, like a room-sized camera obscura.
Right.
Like a walk-in.
So we will recontextualize different object.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry. Yeah, no.
Would you like to paper?
Possibly. Yeah,
I'll stick it here.
Yeah, cheers, thanks. Actually I'll just do a quick last minute core test.
pour faster at the beginning because it's got more pressure. Well, let's see how it goes.
Oh, different pattern?
Actually, if you just hold that a second. I think we'll go for the big one that we did at the start. Okay, help us assemble. Let's do this. Let's go back the other way and try and put on. You go slow and then we'll use up the rest of the patience. Especially over those lines there. Easy. sort of tempted to, because it's only in one corner, I might just sort of do a bit of splattering on the sides. Also, as a sort of, I don't know, we've kind of, how are we doing for time?
Do you have something else?
Well, I've got, I was going to sort of sign them off, as it were. I've got these little...
Let's go.
Smoothly done. Yes. You didn't notice a thing. So this is the thing I was telling you about. So this is I've made these laser cut wheels. Because bicycle cogs have the same, they're all like a half inch pitch. So they stack of bicycle cogs, they all say on them how many teeth they've got. So I was going to get a 23 teethed cog.
just I'll push down there.
Push down and it might be there, that's it. Feel free to ask questions. I must admit to feeling this whole week I've been really nervous about this because this is the first time I've done like it as a performance, and I don't feel like I have done it. I haven't sort of done any sort of jazz hands or sort of you know, dancing around it or anything. But any questions, feel free to ask.